Yep, the name on this one is Asking for Controversy. Ford calls it the Mustang Mach-E, and it's the automaker's path to an electric future. We'll talk about that name in a moment, but first, let's see if it's any good. Okay, so the exterior, there are clearly Mustang-inspired elements. You have the headlights, the low nose, the fenders, definitely the taillights, oh, and of course the badges. But the rest of the shape is clearly not a Mustang. It's a quasi-wagon crossover, and I think it's actually pretty cool. Personally, I wish it was more wagon than crossovers, but crossovers sell, so this shape could prove attractive to EV fence sitters, or even simply new car shoppers casting a wide shopping net. Inside, Ford has created a really nice space. These seats are super comfortable. Everything has a really premium feeling to it, especially this dash covering. And then this screen is integrated really well, and I'm actually really impressed the way they have the volume knob set onto the glass. There's good room in the rear seats and good storage too. You can fold the seats down if you need to get good sized cargo into the rear of the Mach-E. And since it's an electric vehicle, you'll find a front trunk space too. In fact, the frunk is drainable, so you could put ice, snacks, and beverages in there. The Mach-E is a surprise tailgating superstar. The most interesting bit about the Mach-E is, as you'd guess, the propulsion system. Now, this specific model is a Mach-E Premium with the extended range all-wheel drive setup. So we have a pair of electric motors that work to send power to the front and rear axle, and torque can be vectored as needed. Each motor is direct drive, so there's no gearbox. And the combined power output is 346 horsepower and 428 pound-feet of torque. And despite the 4,800 plus pound curb weight, this thing will rip from 0 to 60 in less than 5 seconds. The extended range battery pack on this one is an 88 kilowatt hour unit. Now, the standard range setup is a 68 kilowatt hour system, and then you can spec it with rear wheel drive or all wheel drive. The model lineup starts with the base Select, and that's available with the standard battery pack in rear-wheel drive or all-wheel drive. Then you have the Premium that we have here. Next is the First Edition, which is extended range all-wheel drive only. The California Route 1 model is extended range rear-wheel drive only. Finally, the upcoming GT model will be available with 600 horsepower and up to 634 pound-feet of torque, and a 0 to 60 run in the 3.5 second range. With regards to driving range, the standard range all-wheel drive models get around 211. The extended range rear-wheel drive models get at least 300, if not more. Now, this premium extended range all-wheel drive model is good for about 250 miles on a charge. And if you need to charge on the go, you can do so at 150 kilowatt DC fast charging speeds. Also, charging at an Electrify America station allows you to simply grab the plug and start charging without having to enter payment information at the station. The car and the station talk and get to slinging the juice right away. Another cool feature with the Mach-E is that you can use your phone as a key. That means you can leave the actual physical key fob at home, walk up theoretically to the car and unlock or lock it. And then on the screen, you can see information about your state of charge. You can start the car, lock, unlock, windows up, windows down, horn and lights, trunk, all that stuff. You can also see nearby chargers. It's a pretty great feature if you just want to keep your phone in your pocket. Now, if you don't even want to use your phone or the key, you can also use the touchpad on the door, which is a Ford thing that's been around forever. Get in the vehicle and then enter a code in the touch screen here, and you can drive off without a key, which would be awesome if you were out surfing or hiking, mountain climbing, mountain biking, anything where you didn't want to potentially lose the key. That's a smart way to do it. So obviously it's not going to drive like a rear-wheel drive sports car with a 5-liter V8 under the hood, especially carrying all that curb weight. However, it's an electric car, so there's instant torque. You punch it. I mean, it definitely gets up and goes. It's a fun experience. It's comfortable behind the wheel. There's plenty of power with the brakes, and there's different driving modes depending on how you want to drive this thing. You can actually do a really good one-pedal drive setup with this where you can really actually one-pedal drive it. Some companies are like, it's kind of one-pedal drive. This is legit. The car will come to a complete stop without having to use the brake. I don't have that on right now, and I'm exploring some of the other driving modes. You hit a button on the tablet here. There's a little car in the top left, and there's engage, whisper and unbridled, which is, you know, kind of corny, but whatever, they speak to what it is. Engage is your everyday driving mode, which is a balance between fun and eco-conscious. Whisper is the quietest, the softest throttle response, the lightest steering. It's probably good for, you know, half the consumers. I've left the car and unbridled the whole time, which gives you the most punch, the most throttle response, the heftiest steering, all that stuff to make it somewhat more like a Mustang, like the name implies. Now, Ford says these three different driving modes do not affect your range, which doesn't make sense to me, though I do get it because I'm gonna have a heavy right foot no matter what. And when you put it in the different driving modes, it changes the display in front of you. And I like this minimalist display up here. It works really well. In unbridled mode, there's these gold lines that start to glow and flow forth as you're putting more power down to the car. It's a neat display without being too eye-catching. It's like a minimalist way of having fun with the display. And as I came to a stop, all the gold bits went away and faded back in. But there's just enough information there, it makes sense. Range, state of charge, ground speed, because it's a Mustang, so that's your speed. Car's ready, and if you're in park, reverse, neutral drive, or L is like a low speed gear if you wanted it to, since you can't grab gears and there are no gears, it just holds the engine. It's almost like an engine braking if you were descending a hill and stuff like that. So when you punch it, like I said, it gets up and goes, and it's comfortable, and it's everything you would want from an electric vehicle. I don't know if it's everything you want out of a Mustang, but it is definitely everything you want out of an electric vehicle. I'm really curious to drive the rear-wheel drive version of this because what I found with this all-wheel drive version, if you huck it into a corner, it wants to start to rotate on you and have some fun. So there is playfulness to be found in the Mach-E. And I wonder if the rear-wheel drive version pushes that even further. You have less power on the rear-wheel drive versions because you don't have the dual motor setup pushing out all the juice like this one does to the front and rear axle. But when it wants to vector the torque rearward, I feel like there's fun to be had. I would like to try this on a road course where I have a safety net to push the limits of it and see what it can really do. Now there's a premium to any electric vehicle, and the Mach-E is no exception. The base price is $42,895, not counting destination and handling, but that's also before you apply a $7,500 federal tax credit. Our premium tester is $56,000 as the extended range battery adds $5,000 to the bottom line. Once the GT model becomes available, it should be well into the 60K range. So let's take a minute to talk about the name. Some are up in arms and others don't really care that much. I'm somewhere in the middle. I can see why people are upset, but at the end of the day, it doesn't bother me. Still, I don't think Ford needed to apply the Mustang name to this vehicle. In fact, I think it would have been a lot cooler if they resurrected an older name that we used to use here in the States called the Galaxy. I think that sounds a whole lot cooler. It's a good car, it's comfortable, it's fun to drive, it has a cool shape to it. If the name is the only thing holding you back from giving it a chance, just pop the badges off. I should start a side hustle making Galaxy badges.